Yes, sir.
Hey, hey, what's up, Raj?
Same old, man. We're doing this show, a beautiful show, and with a beautiful guest, Mr. Clinton Fearon today.
I've been looking forward to this episode for quite a while. This is Clinton's second appearance on the show with us. Man, that's
Really crazy. Is this the 29th?
This is the 29th episode, yes.
Jeez. And he was our second guest, right?
Yep, that's right. He was number two. I was just re-listening to that episode today just to kind of like make sure I didn't, you know, talk about the same things we talked about that first time. And wow, what a great guy.
I'm going to ask all the same stuff just because I forget. I got short-term memory.
And it's...
I was Clinton's, Studio One.
It's, yeah, right. So you play bass, right? This is Clinton's birthday month, which is... Oh, yeah.
Raging. You
know, so it's going to be this is the continuation of the birthday celebration for Clinton. So we're going to say happy birthday quite a few times tonight. So happy birthday, Clinton. Thanks for coming on with us.
Half of the show we're doing in a limousine. So
that's right, with a jacuzzi.
Jacuzzi in it. Birthday month.
So we start off the show every week before we get to the guest with something called the record of the week. And today, Roger, I believe it is your turn to go first.
My turn to go first. And I have a really dope record this week. I'm a big fan of a band out of LA called War. Some of you guys may know they do, I guess their most popular hit is a song called Lowrider. Mm-hmm. It isn't really one of my favorites just because, you know, it's one of those things like, you know, the most popular song, like James Brown, I Feel Good. Like, I don't like that song at all either. You know?
Hey.
So anyway, they have lots of other cool hits. And one of the songs they have is a song called Slipping Into Darkness. And so There's a reggae version of that song. When I first heard it, I was really, really stoked. And so, play it. And we'll talk about it after.
All right, here it is.
Such a wicked cover of a wicked song. The band, or the artist singer rather, is called Carl Bert. For me, more importantly, the backing band is a band by the name of the Cimarons. And if for the reggae collectors out there, you've definitely heard of the Cimarons. They were a British band formed in 1967. And they were mostly, they would accompany, you know, Jamaican artists that would come over to the UK and play live shows. They'd be their backing band. And it also translated into actual studio work. There was another backing band by the name of the Rudies. And it was like the Cimarons and the Rudies that were, you know, the primary two backing bands for around that era, 68, 69, that whole skinhead reggae era. And a really cool thing, you know, that I found out is the Cimarons, their other AKA, their AKA is the, what was it? Oh, Hot Rod All-Stars, which is another really cool band out of that same era. If you like reggae, skinhead reggae, man, there's some gold records from the Hot Rod All-Stars, really straight ahead, chuggy kind of stuff. And yeah, man, the backing band is dope. There's a some live footage of them. I know you've seen it, Dev. It's on YouTube. It's that Reggae Edinburgh Festival, 1973. For anybody that's...
Maybe I haven't seen it. I don't know if I've seen it.
It's really, really dope. Like, they're there backing up... the really cool clip is Dennis Al Capone. They're there backing him up.
Okay.
Back up Nicky Thomas, Winston Groovy, if I'm not mistaken. But it's really cool. Judge Dredd, actually, the UK artist Judge Dredd is the guy that's like serving as the host. So he doesn't perform, even though he has done music himself. He's just more of the host, which is cool because, geez, man, Nicky Thomas does a wicked version of Is It Because I'm Black? Stoked. Like, it's the band is like on point. And it's really cool because in that era, or even any eras, you know, before that, there's really not a lot of video footage, you know, of, you know, ska or reggae, a rock steady and early reggae. So to see that, it was like really cool. So go check that out, everyone. Kind of the Cimarons, and type in Edinburgh Reggae Fest. You won't regret it. There's some really cool footage on there. I'm trying to think of what else.
That, I had no idea they were the Hot Rod All-Stars, because I definitely know both groups, but that's super cool to hear that they're the same group.
And it's a trip, right? Because like when I hear some Cimarron stuff, I mean, in like 69, it did sound like Hot Rod All-Stars, I guess. But they kind of, I mean, they found a totally different sound, which was similar to what you're hearing on this cover of Slipping in the Darkness. It's that sound, you know? So,
yeah.
Which both are great. So I can't complain either way. But yeah, man, Cimarron's heavy band for sure.
Super I dig heavy. It. That one you just played, I know I've said this about a few songs we've done, but like that tune I had on a tape that I taped off of Chuck Foster's show probably 20 years ago, that I think that it that had been reissued on some compilation. I think the compilation was called, I think it was called Darker Than Blue. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, it kind of had a blue cover.
I
had some dudes, in like suits or something like that.
And I want to say it was Soul Jazz that put it out, but it might have been like Blood and Fire or
Right Sounds
or one of those. Anyway,
okay.
Yeah. When I first heard that, I didn't know. I was young when I heard that, so I didn't even know it was a cover. I was just like, this is heavy. And that drum fill, you know, that has an extra two beats in it or whatever it is. Like,
yeah. It's funny because I one of the older bands I was in, the Bullets, we covered that. And so when you try to cover that exact part, and I think it's like six, it's not like a four bar thing. It's like goes in two more beats. It's the part where you play it live and you're just kind of like, all right, let's hope we nail this. It can get train wrecked fast. But
that's so funny.
Yeah, man. What do you got this week, man? What kind of?
All right. Well, this week I'm doing something unusual. It's doubly unusual because one, it's the same artist that I played last week for my record of the week. It's another Gladiators tune featuring Mr. Albert Griffiths on lead vocals. And so I don't usually play the same group twice in a row. And then secondly, I don't usually play a tune by an artist that we have on the show that day. And, you know, of course, Clinton is on this. And I have some questions for him about this tune. So I wanted to play it. And after I play it, we're just going to bring him on. So I wanted to show my slide first. This is a tune called Pocket Money by the Gladiators. And this tune I love so much for so many reasons. It's a 12-inch copy that I have, and it's a killer, like, the mix is super dubby. You know, it's not a dub tune. The vocals are in the whole time, but the,
right.
You know, the engineer's dubbing it and flying in and out the rhythm section. And I love Albert's lyrics on this. It's, you've been praying every day only for riches and completely forget about Jah. You've been robbing from the weak and the poor. I can see your only wish is to dwell in abundance and never one day stop to think who's getting hurt. And I love those. I love those lyrics. And so I wanted to just like start with that. And then I'm going to play this tune and then we'll bring Mr. Clinton Fearon on and we'll talk about this and a lot of other subjects. But this is Pocket Money by the Gladiators.
You have been robbing from the weak and the poor.
I can see your only wish is
to dwell in abundance.
I never one day stop to think
who is getting hurt.
But my sheep heard my voice,
and I'll give unto them eternal life.
Yes, my sheep heard my voice.
That tune is just, I don't know, that hits me right in the gut. Let's waste no time and bring Mr. Clinton Fearon on to maybe talk about this song. Yay! Yeah.
Yo, Clinton.
Man.
How you doing, sir?
Greetings, my brethren. How are things?
Good, man. Good. How are you things with you?
Man, you know, I won't complain, you know.
There you go.
Today feel like a better day, like I can smile a little bit, you know. Even if you have to still look over your shoulder a little bit, but you can smile, you know.
For sure, man.
That's true. Man, it's crazy because I was rewatching our first interview with you that was done in May. So what is that, 9 months ago? And
yeah.
And you know, we were talking about like this COVID-19 thing is crazy, and you know, hopefully it'll be over soon, and here we are in January. And
yeah,
but, you know, but we're all still here. Yes. And
yeah, they are saying like 400 people died so far, you know, whether it's correct or not, you know what I mean? Less than that is enough. It's more than enough. 400,000, you know, it's way more. 300 is more than enough. 200,000 is more than enough. You know what I mean? 100, it's more than enough. You know, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
A lot of people lost their lives. You know, it's a situation.
Yep. Yeah, it's insane. I don't think any of us have ever gone through something like this. But you know, here we are. At least we're still here. And I know, you know, you've been doing your live stream every other week, which is really helping people get through this this time, you know.
So thanks, man.
Definitely want to thank you for that and say happy birthday. I know it's your birthday month.
Yeah.
I call it the birth month, you know.
Hey, you
the
got
big
you.
The big 35. How does it feel to be 35, man?
That's a good one. You know,
you at least look it, my friend.
Sometimes
at least look it.
I remember my 35. I definitely partied all month. So enjoy it.
I'll get there someday. I don't know.
You'll get there. You know, I'll be gone on ahead by the time you get there. You know, you know. I'm looking at another 70. You know.
Yeah, absolutely.
For sure.
No reason not to. So, Mr. Clinton, what can you remember about that tune I just played, Pocket Money?
That tune, Pocket Money. You know, I was just talking with Catherine a while ago on a track. I think that's Sly playing drums there. And I think we did it at Joe Gibbs.
Nice.
I think.
It says, I don't know if this jogs your memory. I have it here. It says,
our channel one.
It says produced by Prince Tony. So I don't know.
Yes.
Yeah, see, I got it.
So, yes. So it's either Channel One or Joe Gibbs, I think.
Yeah, it doesn't say the studio on it. It just says produced by Prince Tony, but.
Yeah.
But is that you playing bass on that?
No, I think it's Robbie. I think it's Robbie playing bass. So I think it's Robbie and Sly.
Mm. And that makes sense.
Like pick-up musicians, you know?
Right.
Different songs, something like that, yeah.
How did that, like, real quick question on that is how, at that moment, how was that even decided? Was it just because you didn't want to play bass and you wanted to concentrate on the vocals, or was it more of, you know, someone had an idea or you had an idea? What distinguished you from jumping on that bass versus some of the session players over there?
Tony's idea. You know,
okay.
He was the producer.
Right.
You know what I mean? And usually, a lot of producers in Jamaica, they don't just stick with one musician. You know, they kind of get different feeling and different vibes on different musicians, different drummers, different keyboard, different guitarists. You know what I mean? They split a band in two, take half of that and half over there. A keyboard from over Cimarons, a keyboard, a guitarist from somewhere else. You know what I mean? But by doing so, you get a unique sound. A band is coming with its sound, you know what I mean? Like Gladiators, for example. We have a sound when we play together. We have a sound.
Yep.
You know, so if you split that up, you know, you get a different sound, which is what he was going for. All right.
Gotcha.
That's what he went for.
Gotcha.
And did you guys do your, I know that's an Albert tune with him on lead vocals, but did he, did he write most of the songs that he sang? Is that how you guys did it?
The songs that he sang, he wrote them.
And
the ones that I sing, I wrote them.
Right. Did you guys write,
there is like, one that I sing part of it, and he did the other part that he wrote. that we did at Studio One. Father, today I cry to thee, let not thy enemy overcome me. Right. He wrote that one, but it was where we laid the rhythm, it was a little bit too low for, too flat for him.
Wow.
So I sung part of it and he did the bridge.
Oh, wow. That's one of my favorite tunes. I love that one. It's I mean, one of the reasons I love the Gladiators so much, it's so rare to even get one great songwriter, and you guys had two legitimately great songwriters because,
right.
I mean, go back and forth. It's just like, just all hitters. Do you remember about the tune Pocket Money? Like, would you guys write in the studio, or was it more like Albert would come with the song and you rehearsed it beforehand, or how did that work?
You know, I think Albert wrote it before.
I see. Well, I've always, that song just, I really gravitate towards, you know, a good friend is better than Pocket Money.
Yeah, back then, most of the songs written before we go in the studio.
And so would you rehearse?
There was I think there was one that I remember, Tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the rhythm, Cox and Just Gary, the night before, he done another one. I can't remember which one. And I wrote that one, and Albert wrote the next one. And we went in the next day and voiced them. Cox was, wow. Sir, are you ready already?
So it only took one night to just sit down and write some lyrics, huh?
Yeah. Well, you know, the rhythm already there, you know.
Right.
So, you know, and it's a simple rhythm. So I figured, you know, put simple lyrics to it. Boom.
Right.
You know?
Who's
sometimes at simple songs is what, yeah. Beatles do it all the time, you know?
Right.
Beatles did it all the time, you know, just simple lyrics and some la la and, you know, boom, you know?
Right.
That relate to, you know?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
That's true. Who's playing bass on that original Tribulation rhythm?
You know, I think it's probably Sound Dimension. It could be Leroy Sibbles.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
It could be. Because we just got the rhythm. We don't even know who laid it. But the horns sound like Tamma Cook, you know?
Mm. Yeah.
Wow, that's so many good ones.
We had Mr. Ken Booth on the show last, and he said that he would come in with songs and also direct the horn section, or wherever the instrumental melody was. Did you guys do that as well? Besides writing the lyrics to the progression, would you direct melodies to the horn players?
Yes, I usually love to do that because I always have little parts, you know, especially for my songs.
Right.
Especially for my songs, you know. Yeah. I always have little different parts, guitar licks and things like that.
For sure.
Right. You know, harmony ideas and things like that, you know. Which oftentimes, sometimes never really get met, you know what I mean? But you know, hey, no problem. You know, every little thing helps, you know what I mean?
Right. That's dope.
So I know you had reached out a little while ago and mentioned that you had a couple things you wanted to talk about. One of them was that, you know, Catherine had said that lots of people are interested in the story of Clinton leaving the Gladiators. Did you want to talk about that?
Well, you know, I can talk about that. Leaving Gladiators, let's see how that gets started. You know, 10 years into Gladiators, even before that, you know, I sense trouble. When I say trouble, dysfunction, you know, we're not really moving the same way, you know, vibe-wise, you know. I think as the group grows, you know, swelledness get in the picture, you know, and as this grow more and more, you know, the swelled get more and more, you know. And the same breath, I'm, you know, but I love the group. I love the group a whole bunch, you know. That's why I spent 18 years,
yeah,
you know. during all these times, I've been writing songs, you know, and I would say, you know, 10% of them get recorded. You know what I mean? I have several songs right now that I wrote from way back in the days that's still on cassette, and that never get recorded. That I still have some of those ideas here, you know.
Come over, we'll record them right now. Put that stuff down, man.
Record them too, including myself, you know, but just don't get around to it yet, you know.
Right, of course.
yeah. But you know, I've been kind of romancing the idea for a while, you know. When it after 10 years and I see that things going this way instead of going this way, in terms of getting along and that spirit, you know, of, you know, we're all of us, you know, eating the same dumpling, drinking the same water, and heading the same direction, you know, same purpose, you know, that was kind of not fully there and kind of getting slack, and, you know, and I'm saying, but maybe I'm going to have to make a move. But in the same breath, I'm saying, but I love the group too much. So maybe if I give time, you know, because we all grew up on big people, you know what I mean, and figure, well, you know, that would change the scenario, you know. But instead, you're getting worse and worse.
Just for clarity real quick, Clinton, can you fill us in on how old you guys were at that moment? The age range?
Age range, I would say in the 30s.
Okay.
Late 30s, mid 30s.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. And so when I think it was with I left the Gladiators, and then Albert came back for me. And we tour again a couple of times, and it was the same, if not worse, you know. And so when we toured the U.S. in 87, we finished the tour in Florida, but we had a lot of time on our visas still. And so we call a brethren from up this way, Charlie Morgan, you know, call him up and say, hey, we have a lot of time on our visa and we'd love to do something before going back, if that's possible. And he said, if we can buy our ticket, you know, to come on up. So the drummer, Winston Carter, Clinton Rufus, Morgan, myself, Alric Forbes at the time, we buy our ticket and come this way, you know. And then later on, that's the keyboard, Tarzan, Errol Nelson, join us. He stop off in Texas or somewhere there, and then join us later on, you know. And we did like, say, six, seven months here, you know, and develop a good following and, making more money than we make when we were with Gladiators. You know what I mean?
There you go.
And the road eats up the money, you know. You know the thing. You know, right?
Oh, we know.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. So we make more money being around here, you know. So we decided to use it like a feeding tree, you know, like birds do, you know what I mean? Go home, you know, hey, all right, we're gonna go back up another 6 months, you know, or 2 months and go back in. Well, when we went down, the drummer died, Winston Carter died, which kind of put things on a lull, you know. And then after, like, say, 9 months or something like that, I can't remember, 9 months or a year probably. Yeah, that about a year, you know, come back here again. It was in 89, actually, in 89. We came back and get a drummer here, Greg Jones. Yeah. and get a drummer here, put back the Fenders together, and decide that we're going to keep it going. Mm-hmm. And one of the time, Clinton Rufus went down, and on his way back, he looked at his passport in Miami and said, you see where you're spending more time in the U.S. than you're spending in Jamaica. And put a big red X in his passport and sent him back. You know, it was my turn to go when he come, because what the thing is, we didn't want to like stop the band and we all go at the same time. So we take it one and find somebody to fill the slot.
Right. Until
the person comes back. You understand? Right. Yeah. Right. So that was the idea. So when that happened to Rufus, I decided, you know what? I'm gonna stay and get my papers, you mm-hmm. know, get my so, and I figured it would take me like, you know, a year, maybe a year and 6 months, you know, I get it after 4 years. Mm. By then I grew roots, you know, I'm living here now, you know, I grew roots. It was hard to get up then and say, okay, I'm going back to Jamaica now, you know.
Right.
You know, right. And the longer I stay, is the deeper the roots.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And here I am still.
Wow.
Here I am still. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So at that moment, were you... I mean, were you already you already made your connections? Were you hesitant at making that move of being like, okay, I'm just gonna go all in and just live here?
Well, you know, even at that point, the vibe was still, you know what, you know, I want to make something and see where it takes me, you know. And it was with Defenders, you know. I said, well, okay, all right, you know, still going with Defenders, you know, with the hope that it will get places and things like that, you know. I went
right.
to posters, I do all kind of stuff, you know what I mean, behind right. it, you know, like it's my thing, you know, just feed work, you know.
Right.
And some people weren't pulling their weight, you know. And so, and we did a recording, you know, basically Defenders was like I turned Defenders like a a big, strong lion going down the road with no head.
That's scary.
Yeah, you see what I mean? Right. We were good, and, you know, good musicians in there, and, you know, and everything, you know, the vibe were there in that way. But in terms of, you know, having a goal and get there, it was impossible because there is no leader. And it was kind of started off like that because of what we just came out of. You know what I mean? The leadership in there was a little bit rough, you know, and it just wasn't happening, you know. And so in this case, we figured, you know, hey, we're just going to play some music and have fun, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was a wrong move. We should have put somebody here and say, hey, you're the leader of the group, you know. And that doesn't mean we can't discuss and have opinion and share opinion, da, 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 but you're the leader of the group.
Right. Right.
We choose that person to be. You know what I mean? But that didn't happen. So everybody have different ideas, and the ideas never met. We make a record and it didn't get released and all that and so forth, you know.
Is that recording still, is it still unreleased?
I didn't even know where it is. I kind of divorced myself from that too, you know, because I get frustrated then and figure, say, okay, all right, you know what? I'm going to take care of myself now. So that's when I put Boogie Brown together.
Right.
You know, and here I am today still with Boogie Brown still, you know, because then I figure, you know, and when I did that, I had was to start all over again. I remember my drummer at the time, you know, he quit the same, like today, like tomorrow we have the grand opening of the first gig, as Boogie Brown, you know.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of people showed up at the firehouse, you know, to see what this is like. Some for good reasons, some for just bad reasons. Just want to pick the thing apart, you know. Them
like, yeah, right.
Like, it shouldn't happen. That should not have happened, you know. That. But they're still curious to see what's going to happen. Well, the drummer, we had a good thing going, coming, and the drummer quit the day before the gig. So it's the sound engineer who was a scat drummer at the time, you know what I mean?
There you go.
Scat and jazz, you know, play the drum tonight, who was the engineer, you know?
Wow.
Just to fill us out.
Wow.
Then if we didn't use a drummer, because we would still have somewhat of a groove. He was a good drummer, but everything was too fast.
Mm-hmm.
So then after that, then the second gig.
Must have been so frustrating. That sounds like a nightmare.
The second gig is probably 30 people showed up. You know what I mean? It's like, right. Many people saw what they want to say. Oh, I know it wasn't going to work. Da, 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 da. So I had just to scratch, you know. But I wasn't afraid to start from scratch because I know it can happen. So long as I have musician, I can find musician that is enthusiastic and willing to learn the thing. And then I am patient. I exercise some patience and get it work and keep on growing. That was the idea. And that's still the idea.
Mm-hmm.
We can't play any music right now for the most part, you know, because mm-hmm. of the situation, but, you know.
So you're obviously the leader at this point of the Boogie Brown Band. What prevented that leader role from being filled with the previous band? Was it more of an ego thing that, like, you know, they didn't want to, the rest of the guys in the band didn't want you as a leader, or was it something that maybe you weren't ready to be a leader of that band? Because I'm trying to understand why no one stepped up to actually be a leader.
Because of the previous situation, and we, you know, we didn't look at it carefully enough and to see that it would cause problem, you know?
Okay.
There was this freedom vibe. There was a freedom there. Like, you know, we feel like we can breathe. We feel like we can breathe and just play some music.
Right.
But then comes the business of it where, okay, all right, you know, we need to be rehearsal times this time. Hey, we're going to do this recording at this time. And it's for this purpose. And, you know, somebody who is you know.
Right.
Come on, then everybody start to dictate what they think is right from what's not right, what's wrong from what's not wrong. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And there's that a leader there to say, okay, guys, this is it. This is what we're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? In order to put a vein there. That wasn't there, you know? And so at one time when we, you know, I look at the vibe and I say, hey, we need to get out of Seattle because, you know, we were doing well around here, but we need to go elsewhere and do well too as well, you know? But it would take some money and energy and we wouldn't make as much money as when we play around here, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Well, some cats don't want to do that. Actually, the only cat that was fully interested in that was Eric Forbes, actually.
Hmm.
You know, keyboard player wasn't interested in that. You know, drummer wasn't too interested in that either.
Right.
I
was going to say, all of this must be somewhere in the back of your head when you're like, at some point, you know what? I'm just going to make an acoustic record because I know I'm going to show up. And
well, I tell you what, at that time, what I did, I see it's going a certain way, I had some recording that I brought from Jamaica with me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I decided, well, this not going good. So you know what? I'm going to put these up, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I made a cassette. Actually, when I got to the studio of the tape, two-inch reel, you know, got to a studio and put it on, the bacon started to come off.
Oh, no. Oh, geez.
off. So I had to quickly run off some of those songs, run off, you know, and make some other ones because, you know, anyway, it was a mess. It was a mess. So I put something together and that's a cassette called Feel the Spirit. You know, the cassette, I think it had 10 or something like that, songs on it. I can't remember. Mm-hmm. But I put that record in and, you know, and I still have it as a side thing. It's not as a major thing, just as a side thing, just to, because we keep telling people, hey, we're coming with something, and it's not coming. And from the moment when I did that, oh, others who really want to do something like that before just jump on that and that wagon and do something to what nothing get done with the group itself as a group, you know. Mm-hmm. So more and more it's going this way again, you know. Right. But I didn't, it's way later with the acoustic thing, is way later with Boogie Brown. Right. And some of Boogie Brown members at the time actually had to encourage me to do acoustic.
Wow. Going back, I want to go back to you actually leaving the Gladiators. You knew what you wanted to do. You knew what your next step was going to be. Did the rest of the guys in the band, were they supportive of that at that moment? Or was it something that kind of, you know, created some tension?
No, everybody was wanted was to do something else because, like I said, it wasn't a good situation that we were in.
So it was more of a relief thing. Everyone's relieved they get to go
to do something.
Right, but okay.
We wanted to do something together, you know?
So
the idea was to do something together and still go back to Jamaica. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And mm-hmm. and when that happened, when the drummer died, you know, that kind of split things up, and you could feel that there's a big split in the group in terms of unity, you know, and okay, all right. So it's not gonna work, you know, and that's why we come back again and put it together again a second time with a new drummer.
Right.
So everybody was kind of feeling that. It wasn't like
Everybody was kind of feeling that. Everybody was kind of feeling. And that's why, again, there wasn't a leader because, you know, everybody feeling that freedom, like, yeah.
That makes a lot of sense.
You know? And then, you know, drummer used to sing, Alred sing, I sang, you know what I mean? And even Clinton Rufus sing sometimes, you know, it's like, but in Gladiators, that wasn't possible. Mm-hmm. You know, I was lucky that I got a squeeze through with a few songs on some of those albums.
So it wasn't possible because it was really Albert's group.
It's Albert's group. You know, yeah. Mm-hmm. But we loved the group and wanted to support the group and believe in the group. I personally believed in the group, you know. And my way of being in the group back then too was like, you know, and I even tell some of the same members, like, you know, hey, I'm not here to serve anyone. You know, what I'm here to do is build Gladiators. You know, so I see Gladiators as an entity to build. And give my energy and my all to it, not to you, because, you know, I'll get disappointed. You know what I mean? So I was to find a way out to
well put
to put my energy there and feel good.
Right.
And you know, you mentioned, you know, you really believed in the group and you know, obviously there was people outside the group feeling that way too, because you were, I mean, that song Pocket Money I played was from, that's a Virgin release, you know, and you guys were signed to Virgin Records for a little while, which was a, you know, a major label. And, you know, what was it like being signed when you first got signed to that, to, you know, a kind of a major label? Was there like a hopefulness that like, okay, this is going to be a big break the way it was kind of for Bob when he, you know, did a major label?
Well, yeah. We had aspiration, we have expectation, and also, but we just want to make music and have it be out there as much as possible, and hit the world with it, because that's the dream, you know. Mm-hmm. And actually, little before that, Know Yourself, Mankind, that song. Uh-huh. It's the song that Prince Tony took to Virgin's, and then we got the contract, you know. And what happened is that song was supposed to be Albert's song, and we were supposed to go in the studio and lay something for myself, because at that point, you know, before we laid that song, Albert said to me at one time that, well, this year, you know, well, not the group is not happening, and why, well, so, you know, and I don't want to hold back anybody. So, you know what, you know, maybe you should do your one thing and I do my one thing. At this time, it's just kind of me and him alone now, because everybody, we're not making any money. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of he and I alone, and I said, well, you know, maybe you should do your own thing and I do my own thing, and we support one another, you know. Mm-hmm. I agree mm-hmm. to that, you know. So if I have the song Know Yourself, Mankind, me and him and drummer Winston Carty, and I remember, I think, Clinton Rufus, I think, you know, went and laid the rhythm. I think Audley Taylor too as well, you know, went and laid the rhythm, and yeah, and we voice it, and he took it to Prince Tony. Mm-hmm. And Prince Tony took it to England, and then when he came back with and said, hey, them guys have a contract for the period, you know, he said, okay, all right. So everybody face bright up back again and figure, okay, all right.
Of course.
When you were first, you know, so you got your contract with Virgin, and then I imagine that you went and talked to some people at Virgin at some point and had some meetings. I mean, what was the vibe like between, you know, you guys being like a roots, I mean, like you're coming from a whole genre that's roots, but you guys are like the roots of the roots. And then, you know, there's a major record label you're dealing with. And was there any kind of conflict or tension between, like, you know, the kind of songs you guys wanted to write and maybe like what a label was expecting you to do? Or was it more like a free vibe, just do your thing?
It was still kind of a free vibe, and Tony had his freedom too as well. We kind of, because Tony was the producer at the time, so sometimes he would say, oh, Albert, I don't like this one, yeah, come with another one, you know. But not regular that he would do that, you know.
I see.
But I remember there was this song we called, I think it's called The Gladiators. I think it's The Gladiators. One that Eddie Grant produced. You know, we have all the lines for it and everything for it and things like that. And then, you know, we went to England. And they thought it would be a good idea, you know. Personally, I didn't like the idea because I have some badass bass line that I wanted was to play. Mm-hmm. I didn't get to happen, so I didn't like the idea. But I rode with it, you know, because, you know, it's mm-hmm. a group, you know what I mean?
Right.
And Eddie Grant did a good job, you know, to his capacity, I think, you know, and some good musicians play on it. Angus play drums on it. And I can't remember the rest.
Was it Aswad? Aswad played?
Aswad drummer. Yeah.
Right. Played on it.
And I think a bass player that plays sometimes with, it's a bass player that Eddie Grant got that played bass on it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And up to, you know, a lot of people still love the album, but for me, I think, maybe I'm biased, but I think that's the album that I like the less.
Which album is this again? What's the name of the album?
It's called Gladiators.
Okay. What year is that?
What year was that? It's one of them that have a G, a big G.
Hmm.
And there's a fire burning, the G is burning.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We are kind of behind the G.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I don't have that one, so I can't I have to take your word for it.
Are there hands on the cover or something like that? Maybe I'm thinking of something
else.
No,
that's that one.
It's that one. So, okay.
That's Trenchstone mix.
Trenchstone. That's what I'm thinking. Okay.
That's a good record.
That's a good record.
You know what?
Proverbial reggae is one of my favorites.
Yeah, that one, Naturality, those three are just...
And then
I got, since we're talking about album covers, I just got to ask you about this one, Sweet So Till, because this is, what is the inspiration behind this reggae, behind this album cover? How do you guys think of this?
Yeah, I know. It's actually, that wasn't our idea at all. It wasn't Prince Tony's idea either. It's Virgin's idea.
Mm-hmm.
Their artists do something, you know.
Wow.
Like that, you know. And I mean, you know, as a cover, it is cool.
It's cool.
But based on the songs, if it was me, I wouldn't do a cover like that. You know what I mean?
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. So the artwork doesn't match the songs. My opinion.
No.
You said it, not me. But yeah, I know what you mean for sure, because it doesn't. That's why I wanted to always ask you about this, because
it's nice.
But yeah, it's not necessarily the direction I would have first expected to go with that album. But super great album, though. Yeah.
It's true. It's
really good.
Hey, I hear you were playing a song there earlier with the Cimarons.
Yeah, man. The Slipping in the Darkness tune.
Yeah. You know, they were one of my favorite groups from outside of Jamaica, you know?
There's something about them, right? I mean, they got it. They got the sound pretty good. Yeah.
Didn't they do Talking Blues? Weren't they the one that did Talking Blues? Faf Bob.
You talking about the Talking Blues album?
I don't know if it's an album, but the song Talking Blues.
Hmm.
They actually made a hit out of it before Bob.
No kidding. I didn't know that. No.
I didn't know that either.
Yeah, you didn't know that.
No.
And during that time, I met them over by Scratch. They came over Scratch at one time.
And that was around?
Just visiting, right.
Wow.
And then later on, Bob did it over.
Okay. You
know, he did his thing on it, you know. It was excellent. But Cimarons was really good.
I got to check that out, man.
Check it out.
They're a great band. How did you guys feel like when you started hearing groups from England doing reggae in those times, you know, like early 70s and, you know, even late 60s, like when you started hearing that stuff, how did you guys as Jamaican musicians, like, did you like it or did you think it was weird or?
No. Well, you know, there is Jamaica, there's a sound that hard to replicate, you know. It's hard to copy that there's a feeling, there is the attitude, the whole thing, the tonality, the accents, you know what I mean? It's a little different.
Yep.
You know, and sometimes I think even the electricity is probably a little different, which give you a different, I can't find the word, you know, a different sonic sound. The sonic a little different too. So, you know.
I heard that somewhere.
I think Val Douglas was telling us.
The musicality of those musicians, you know, Oswald, there is Steel Pulse, Cimarons there, you know. They were good groups, man. And, you know, really playing the music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I felt good because I'm saying, man, I'm from the country. I'm from way
in the
country.
You're like, you didn't do it like us, boys.
Yeah, I'm seeing these cats doing the thing. It's like, okay, that means the music is spreading. You know what I mean?
Right.
But, you know, some people don't like it. you know, thinking, see it as competition. I don't see it as competition. I see it as growth. Mm-hmm. I see it as growth, you know. From long time, I say, you know, I always have it to say, when I write a song and it's only me alone hear it, it's my song. As soon as somebody else hear it, it's not mine anymore, it's ours. You know what I mean? And the more it spread, it's the less I own it. Like, mm-hmm. like it's the, mm-hmm. to say it's my song. Yeah, I have the copyright on it, blah, blah, et cetera. But in terms of, because 1,000 people can go and sing this song.
Don't get it twisted, it's my song, but.
yeah, you know what I mean?
You're like, the publishing's mine.
I ain't
sharing the publishing, but the feeling of the song, you can have a little piece.
No, that's a great, I mean, that's such a great way of looking at it, because it's really true. It's really true.
It's
annoying
true.
When you see an artist who, like, gets jaded about their own popular songs. If people request the song all the time and they're like, oh, again, this song. And it's like, no, you should be happy that you wrote a song that people love so much that they want to hear it over and over again, you know, because this song is theirs now. You're absolutely right about that.
You're totally right, man. You're totally right. You know, like, rich man, poor man, chat him out, on the other side, streets mm-hmm. of freedom, those songs. Most time I have to have them in my repertoire because, you know, people are looking for them.
Right.
You know, especially when we tour abroad and things like that. Mm-hmm. You know, like here in Seattle, you know, my audience, they get used to hearing new songs, you know. Mm-hmm. So after I hear them, when I hear what next I'm coming with, you know. Mm-hmm. But cats from far away, you know, they use and they have that on their turntable year after year, you know, and I managed to tour there. Of course they want to hear that, you know. They're disappointed if them don't get it, you know. So, mm-hmm. But I'm honored, you know. Yes, I might feel like, oh, I did that last night already, but, you know, sometimes it saved me too, because they sing the song so loud and right there that I can take a breather.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. They help me sing it, you know what I mean? So it's mm-hmm. a blessing in any way you look at it.
You know, maybe that might be one of the unexpected surprise benefits of all this live stream stuff, because, you know, now so many people from around the world are kind of having that same experience you just mentioned that people in Seattle would have of, like, oh, they start to know the new stuff. Well, now, you know, you might be surprised. You might go on the road, you know, whenever that starts happening, and people are like, you know, we heard you play that one tune so many times. Now we want to hear that. You know, I've noticed that in my own little live stream stuff. Songs I haven't even released, people have been requesting them. So it's like, okay, cool. This is kind of good. I like this.
This lockdown thing. It's educational. It's in more ways than one. You know, it's teaching us that we do need one another. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it's also teaching us that we are not alone. You know what I mean? So, and technology is helping us to discover all that. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. When you look back, then you have a 500, 1,000, 2,000 people in front of you, and everybody having fun together is like one energy. You know what I mean? I miss that.
Yep.
Yeah, man.
But this is also good. This is also right. good. It's just a pity, you know, that it get to this because of, you know, the kind of crisis, you know, the pandemic and things like that.
Yeah.
And you do an amazing job, by the way. I mean, you have segments like Talk with a Friend, right?
Yes.
And then you have, obviously, you know, Sunday with Clinton Fearon, which, by the way, I saw the last Sunday's, the birthday special one, man. And that one was great, as always.
Thank you, man.
You do an amazing job. I think a lot of musicians, I mean, obviously, none of us have gone through something like this. So it's either sink or swim. And, you know, that's why I tell other musicians is you have to make the best out of the situation. And if it involves doing live streams and making content, then so be it.
It's true. What it also takes is humility. It's humility. You know, you don't have to be more than you are. You know, you come with your heart, and if you're used to come with your heart, then this is not hard. Mm-hmm. You know, in that sense, you know what I mean? You're more like feel shy about the thing more so than big shoulders, you know what I mean? But if you come with your heart all the time, you depend on that vibes of coming with your heart. And usually people accept your heart quicker than anything else. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody got a heart, you know, and we got feeling. Even though we're tough, we want to be like, oh man, I'm a tough cat, you know, nothing bothers me. I don't cry, buddy. You know what I mean?
Like Roger.
They have a heart.
I cry all the time.
Roger brought up talk with a friend, and could you talk to us a little bit about that? What is the Talk with a Friend series for people who might not have caught it yet?
Oh, Talk with a Friend. Talk with a Friend is how to explain it. Talk with a Friend is like
it's like talking with a friend. I've seen it. I mean,
it's like talking with you.
Yeah. There you go. I love it.
Yeah. Like what we're doing here is talk with a friend. You know,
definitely.
The little difference is that, you know, I asked my friend to, you know, usually ask my friend to play a song or two for me. And they would in turn ask me to play a song or two for them, you know what I mean? But basically is to discuss and see how you're doing, how I'm doing, how we are doing, how your family, how we surviving, you know?
And I saw you had Mike Love on recently. That was a good one. Right.
And this is happening, and Talk with a Friend is happening on Instagram, for those who don't know.
You know? Oh, okay, cool.
Right. It's an Instagram thing. You know,
nice.
And the Sunday with Clinton Fearon is on Facebook.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, those have been great. And who do you have? I think you have your friend Rufus coming up, right?
Next Wednesday. You know, I'm excited about that one. We have a long history. You know,
is that the Rufus you were talking about just a little while ago? Same.
Yeah.
All wow. right, I can't wait for that. What's the date of that one?
Good musician, man. Huh?
What's the date for that show?
I know it's next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
January 27th. I know the date. Yeah. There you go.
Right.
I got you. That's gonna be good. Can't wait for that. That's a great. It's so cool because I think, you know, sometimes artists don't like. I think your approach that you're taking of the whole like humility and just putting your heart out there for people is the absolute right one, because people really connect to that, and people love to see, you know, it's nice to see your favorite artist getting interviewed, but it's even nicer to see an artist kind of talking to another artist that they both have a mutual or just a friend, you know, people are two people as an audience member. Like I know people tuned in and they love Clinton Fearon, they love Mike Love, and to see you guys talking to each other, that's a whole other special thing, you know. It's a really kind of a brilliant model. It's awesome.
Because it showed human. It showed humanness, you know. Because oftentimes, you know, a part of your audience will see you on a pedestal, you know, on a different level, you know. When, you know, you're just human like them, just doing your thing. And they're doing their thing. They could be a shoemaker, but they're a badass shoemaker. And if you watch them make shoes, you would say, whoa. You know, or you may watch them make a sunglass, you know, say, whoa. You know what I mean? If you watch them do what they do, like they watch you do what you do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's just human, you know. But the more popular you get, you know, is the more like you're excluded. It's like, I can't touch him or I can't touch her. Yeah, oh boy.
Right.
You know, which sometimes left us isolated if you're not careful, you know. And sometimes we ourselves isolate our own selves because we think that, you know, for whatever reason, instead of being just simple, are humble about the thing, you know. You want to get to the gig in a limousine, Well, already that gonna prevent people from see you. Mm-hmm. You understand? I'll get close to you, and then you have bodyguards and the red carpet. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like Roger again.
I like limousines, though. I mean, you got drinks in the limo.
Well, the thing is, you know, you use the limousine, you know, let the limousine use you, you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah, there you go.
Take away your personality.
My feet out. Yeah.
Like, take away your personality.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, right?
Most definitely.
Your friends into the limousine.
Right, there you go. Invite your fans and friends. Yeah, come on in the limo. Let's share this together. For sure. No, I know what you mean. I mean, there's artists, I know we've all met them, you know, where you go up and you think they're going to be more reserved or a certain kind of way, and they're just really nice and easygoing and easy to talk to. And so I definitely, that involves what you're talking about, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, at one point, you know, I remember because, you know, I'm shy about it too, like approaching, you know, people who I admire and rest and see them here as wow musicians and singers, you know. I remember times going like this, you know, the few times I do it, you know, like mm-hmm. going backstage, you know, check artists and say, hey man, great job. He's like, they don't want to have anything to do with me. He's like, oh, okay. You know, I hardly do, unless I really know the person. I don't do it, you know?
Yeah, I'm the same, actually.
I want to, let's ask a fun question now. On that, who was someone back in the day, Jamaica, that you were like the first person you were really starstruck over, some kind of artist or whatnot?
Oh, so
that you met, like some exactly like we're talking about, that you met and...
There's so many, man. Ernest Ranglin played on my...
That's a good one.
Ernest Ranglin played on a couple of my songs in Jamaica, you know, produced by Prince Tony. Mm-hmm. And we were up by Ari J. I remember we were up by Ari J. And he's playing and I'm going in the mixing room. And my mouth kind of reached my ears.
Still when
he finished, I couldn't get the courage to tell him what I think of him, you know what I mean? Wow. From I'm in the country, man, I hear him playing, don't know who it is, and I'm saying, whoa.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can't remember, I think it's Albert CM one point him out to me and say, hey, you know, Ernest Ranglin, that, you know, oh yeah. You know, come check Coxon, you know, we're waiting down by Coxon to do recording, you know, and he just come check Coxon quickly and gone again, you know. And then when him come play upon things for me there and things like, you know, for Gladiators, you know, and I want to tell him so much what I think of him, you know, and how much him influenced me and things, you know, I couldn't do it. I didn't get the courage. And then he came to, I think, in Salem. I think it's Salem. It's a bit, there's a spot there between Eugene and Portland, you know. And they did a gig there. And, I went to see him. Cedric Brooks was on the gig too as well. Nice. And Andy guitarist Andy was there too as well and who again I can't remember but and a percussionist from back mm-hmm. were there anyway. I go on the back and you know and I go check them. I check him and I told him, you know, and I told him what him play on the songs for me and thing like that. And he said. You know, I don't remember. He said, I don't remember. I play on so much songs, I don't remember. But I just take it, you know, and say, okay, it's all right, you know. But I let him know how I felt, you know. But I see that him still don't know how much, you know. And mm-hmm. then he did that song for me in Jamaica there when Time, where him did the jazz version, the solo. You know, I told him again, I didn't get to see him in person, but like, I told him again on the phone when I was down there, and I said, hey, so-and-so, you know, and he had no idea how much. And I think it started to seep in then, you know. And when the engineer who record his part, mm-hmm. Carmel, when he was in the studio, and he and I talk a little bit, and he told me, he said, I asked him, I said, hey, what you think of the song, you know? And he said, I love how you use the melody. I love the chord changes. I love what you did with it, you know? And right. I said, something tell me that him start to feel that the influence, you know what I mean? Because I kind of structured the chord a little bit, kind of like how, you know, because I love to play in harmonies, you know, in chords, in harmonies, you know, instead of playing just one note. Mm-hmm. He do one note things still, but he love to play in chords too, you know what I mean?
Yep.
And on Time, I kind of did some of that, you know what I mean? So I'm quite sure he noticed something, you know. Yeah, you know, and then, you know, the other person that I admire a whole lot as a musician, see Clinton Rufus there, you know. Clinton Rufus is a good musician, you know. Mm-hmm. A lot of people don't even realize it. You remind me a little bit of he's from Lintit.
Oh,
yeah, man.
You know about Lintit?
Wow, that's high praise.
Okay.
Lovely.
Oh, definitely. Well, Rocksteady King.
Lintit is a little bit more out there. You know what I mean? Like you take things from way out here. You would think, what is he doing? But at the end of his phrase, he said, oh, damn. You know what I mean?
Right.
You know. Right. And Rufus kind of embedded right there in the blues flavor. You know, he's good in there. You know, and steady and on point, you know.
Nice.
Yeah. But yeah, so many singers, you know, Delroy Wilson was one of my favorite, you know. Slim Smith was one of my favorite. John Holt was one of my definite favorite. Wow. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, all these singers, you know, that, you know, CM Ken Booth there too, you know. And I remember at one time, I think I said, Ken, boy, I said, Ken, you remember when you were doing this? And now that my baby has gone away, this will give you the privilege to come and stay.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. I think yes. The studio, you know, the corners, you know, chilling, you know, boom, go. Come to the song. Come ready, man. Come to the song, man. One cut.
Wow.
So you were there watching him record that song?
I say, man, you have no idea. Yeah. But I wasn't brave enough. I just was not brave enough, you know, for all of them, you know. Bob again, you know, still wasn't brave enough to say, you know, yeah. I remember over scratch there and Bob come over there and check. I'm playing bass and Bob hang over the board and wait, how I play the mean bass line there? You know, and he and I sit outside, feel like 5-10 minutes just sit there, just the two of us alone, and I don't know what to say to him.
Wow.
Because you know when you admire somebody that's really going at the gut of the thing, you know, it's like, so I mean, I say, you know, I know, you know, a lot of people claim that, you know, oh, oh, Bob make it because he's white. It's not true. Not true. Bob come from down here, so with it. Mm-hmm. Bob come from the gut with it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You can still listen to the song them today. You can hear so well done and come from some place with it. It's not just edify. You know, it's a gut feeling. It's a vibe. So mm-hmm. well deserved, my opinion.
Was that kind of the majority opinion you feel, or was there a lot of people on the island that were they bitter because of that?
Some people just jealous. I think it's just people jealous.
Right.
I think that's what it is. You know. Yeah. And then there is also, you know, people on the racist tip of things, you know, either one side or the other. Right. You know what I mean? Like everywhere else. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But like them saying, you know, Satan find work for idle hands. It's also find work for idle thoughts. You know, understand?
Yeah.
better you go write a song or write a bass line or write a guitar lick, you know what I mean, than to go and think negative, you know, because music is like love, you know. Music is like love. It no see no color, you know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. You know
what I mean? And it's a language, whoever can speak it.
Yeah. That's true.
Again, that's my philosophy.
No, I think you're right. And I totally agree with you about Bob in particular, because, you know, Roger and I, we're so deep into reggae music and Jamaican music, and we know so much, like so many obscure groups, and we love, like, you know, to show people songs they've never heard. And so it would be easy for us to, you know, say like, oh, Bob, he's the most popular. We kind of don't. But no, I still say Bob is the best songwriter I've ever heard. Like just like you said, his songs come from somewhere where you're just like, whoa, how did you figure out a way to express that feeling that every one of us feels in a simple way and yet in a new way? It's like new but simple at the same time. And every single one, there's no bad Bob Marley song. And I mean, how many? It's just insane.
I remember a quick story. When I was in school at a young age, I actually wrote like a paper that was like not anti-Bob Marley, but it was very like kind of saying Bob Marley's not the only one. Because at that point I was like Mr. Little Rude Boy, all into rock steady, and there was like praise on so many other artists like Delroy Wilson or, you know, whoever, Ken Booth. And, you know, you grow up listening to Jamaican music, and then you look back and like we're all saying, you know, Bob Marley is, you know, the face of reggae music for a reason. Just the
for a reason. And like you may say, you know, Slim Cement. Mm. Slim Cement. I can put on a Slim Cement any old day, you know, and feel good. You know? Yep. And it hit me different from how Bob music hit me. Mm. You know, it's kind of a revolutionary type, you know, it's chant, you know, It's telling a story in a painful way, but mm-hmm. in the same breath, you know, it's not for him, it's for us. That's the vibe you get. That it's not for him, it's for us. And I love that kind of feeling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it makes sense too. That no, in fact, that when him get money, him give a lot of it to poor people in Jamaica. Mm-hmm. That's one of the things we're getting in trouble out there too. You know what I mean? With the politicians, them out there, you know, them didn't do like the idea that him was getting so popular and people love it. You know?
Right. And he even spent all that money on the show, the concert in Zimbabwe, because he wanted to play there so much, and they didn't have the money to bring over the equipment, and so he just spent some crazy amount of money getting, you know, bringing over the amplifiers and the speakers and all that stuff. He paid for that. But, you know, we could talk about Bob all day long.
There is that. But, you know, again, you know, I think everyone do their dues or pay their dues or do their part. That's mm-hmm. what I want to say. You know, Delroy Wilson, you know, was one of my very favorite, you know, see him Dennis Brown there again, mm-hmm. you know, where, you know, did their part, you know, when you put Bob aside and take up Dennis and say, okay, I'm going to Dennis vibe. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You can see why he's loved all through the different genres.
Yeah.
Dennis is there. You know, Dennis is right in there. You know what I mean? It's like, he was good, you know?
Yeah.
Some artists, it's they have a time frame and then that's it. You know, mm-hmm. some just fit in the rock steady. Some just fit in the reggae. Some just fit in the ska. You know what I mean? And you have some cross all of those genres. You know, just cross them and right in there with it coming along. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But you know, there's several that I admire. You know, the ones that I don't admire mostly is the ones them that you know the too much a big head and too broad shoulders and think that you know them better than the next person. Mm-hmm. You know, then that don't sit well with me, you know, because I know that's farce. You know what I mean? Because the person who is big today can be small tomorrow. One little youth just born to blows not and come up and bad no blows not and all of a sudden you take back seat. You know what I mean? To this little youth just go wicked no blows not. You know what I mean? It's like that's why it makes sense to just be humbly do your thing and know that there's much more to learn.
It's much more of a productive vibe too, because even if you're right and you are going to be big for you know decades or whatever, it's just there's nothing to gain with that kind of attitude. It's just off putting, you know. No one likes it. So we know that you has made a documentary, a Clinton Fearon documentary called Rich Man Poor Man. Is this true?
Yes. It's coming. It's coming. You probably see a little teaser clip of it there, right?
Yeah.
Right, and I think there should be some more coming at some point in time down the line. There, I don't have all the details on it. You know what I mean? But you know, I'm feeling good about it. I'm feeling good about it. I'm waiting to see it too.
did the director or the producer or whatever come down to your pad and talk to you for a while, or how was it shot?
Oh, he's from Seattle here. He's okay. living in the area.
Okay, so
you know, and basically, you know, it started from, you know, they used to come see me at Nectar all the time and have the idea and approach us and you know, and we start to move together and say, hey, why not? You know? And then start to take footage and build up on it over the years. And it come a point now where we say, well, try to do something.
That's great. I was so happy when I saw that's in the works, because you're like the perfect candidate for such a thing. You know, we talked about Leonard Dillon last time we had you on the show, and I just always, you know, before he passed, him and I had developed a little bit of a relationship just from playing some shows together. And I, you know, like you're talking about, like those artists like that you see and you're like, that was always Leonard for me. I just was just like, I don't know how to tell him how much. And so it's just always a regret for me that I didn't, like, I wanted to go down there and like spend a month with him and write his biography, you know, and just write a whole thing, and you know, never really got to. There's some interviews with him, but nothing like he deserved, you know. So
talking about that, he was one of them too. He was one of them, because you know, in terms of their melody and the simplicity of the song, and they're always just two chord songs. But what they did with the two chords, you know. Oh man, that's cleverly done. You know what I mean? And his tone. And Ian Albert were friends.
Right.
So that's how I get to know him. You know? And I remember when we were doing One Prophet Come, Two Prophet Come, you know, that's you know, my early days of playing this. You know what I mean? And I'm saying, I'm playing for Ethiopians. All right, cool. You know,
that's such a killer album, man.
You know, when you used to sing song, I wasn't even in the business yet. You know, I'm just looking to get into it. When before, you know what I mean, and then get to meet him and say, oh, that Ethiopia, that's Ethiopian. And say, Iman Vin, the virgin name was Vin, yeah, Vin, and
Steven was his singing partner.
Melvin Reed. But and then the short one, I think his name was Vin. And he got in an accident out on the boulevard and
right.
Something hit him and he died, right. But it was a nice group, man. And then did some song back in the day, you know, where you know, people who don't know would think that they were like, you know, Dread Rasta and thing like that and say, you know, they never dread, but them sing the songs.
Right. Yeah, totally. Yeah, Ethiopians and Gladiators. That's just like, I told you this last time, I just grouped the two of you guys together just because of the style. Different, you know, different melodies and everything, but just like early roots, you know, innovative stuff. Right, that, you know, just like it's crazy. Yeah. The innovation.
Imagine same show, same stage, that man, era.
That Dread.
Yeah. You know, when we was learning to play bass, mm-hmm. you know, we borrowed Leonard Dillon, a box from Leonard Dillon to help, you know. I think I actually have a little amp head, and he lent us a box, you know. like a little bin that we use. It's not really a bass bin, but we use it to play the bass through.
Wow. Because he was like an electrician or something, right? I heard he did some electrical stuff. Oh,
I do know what he was, an electrician. I know Albert used to work on a building and doing some building work, and he used to do some building work too for this man, with a guy named who them did them first recording for. Something that Lee, the guy named, you know.
That they did their first.
Anyway, they used to work for the guy, and the first recording I think Albert did with and Leonard Dillon and Albert, they do like a back to back record,
yeah.
A side, B side.
Yeah, it was Train to
Scaville. I don't remember the record, right?
It was Train to Scaville, and then Albert's was, I think, like Rocksteady Train or something like that.
Train is coming back, my friend.
Yeah.
Is that one?
Yeah, I think that's that one.
Trains were in that year.
Yeah, it was the Train record. Yeah, Train to Scaville and then Rocksteady Train. Because Train to Scaville was always a crazy record to me, because I'm like, does nobody notice that this is not a ska song? Like, why is this called Train to Scaville? It's a Rocksteady. So then on the flip, Albert's like, you know what? No, this is a Rocksteady Train. Like, that's what we're going to call it.
Yeah. They weren't in Scaville yet. They were taking the train to Scaville.
Yeah.
I gotta look into it.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking about all these records. I have another one to ask you about. This one here, it's Gladiators on one side and Don Carlos on the other, and it's a Channel One.
The Channel One, right?
And it's this one, man. The Gladiators side is just, I mean, I like the Don Carlos stuff too, but I wish the whole thing was Gladiators, because it's just, I've never even heard a record that sounds like this. It's got, you know, Can't Stop Righteousness on it, and, you know,
right.
I know everything, but the Gladiators band is just so wicked on it, and the production style, it's similar to Pocket Money in the sense that it's every song is kind of dubbed. It's not a dub, but it's like every song has got that dub feeling.
Right.
And, man, I love that record.
I think that was a Channel One production, actually.
Yeah, Channel One. It's part of their series. Right. They had a series of albums called Showdown, and it would be one artist on one side and a different artist on the other. And this one is Gladiators and Don Carlos. Yeah, Channel One, Showdown Volume 3. I love this. Mm. Do you remember anything about recording this record and writing it and everything?
Oh, I remember doing the recording. I don't remember. We weren't there when they joined them together. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? During all that whole process, I didn't even see Don Carlos. We got done separate times.
Right. That makes sense. It's different bands. It says it's Roots Radix on the Don Carlos side, and then the Gladiator side is Gladiators band.
Right. Yeah, but it was fun. It was fun, and it was something else. And Channel One was bumping at the time, you know. So we figured, it was cool to do that. You know,
right.
A lot of people like that. I like it too myself. I actually love it, you know. It was fun. It was fun to do.
That's a great record.
Yeah, man.
And the there's one other thing I really wanted to ask you about. Last time you mentioned the pre-Gladiators days with the brothers, and you kind of mentioned it, and then we moved on, and I was like, I really want to know some more about the brothers. Is there, I think you guys released some stuff, right? Or am I wrong about that?
No,
I
feel like, we didn't release anything. Mm. We were just doing additions, you know, and going places. It's during that time that I met the Gladiators. Because the thing is, I want to do music so bad, but I also love harmony, you know. And so, you know, when I wrote the song unto my two brethren, you know, two of them could sing a little bit, not too good, but a little bit. So my idea was, okay, all right, I will let one sing the lead, and then I coach the other one on harmony. You know, mm-hmm. I harmonize the other one, you know what I mean? And you know, while one is doing the lead, you know, I didn't care who doing the lead. I just want the song to happen, you know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah. And I remember we went to, we did get accepted at Treasure Island. And wow. And funny enough, when we go to record, you know, Gladiators was recording a song, and they took all the time that they had. You know, all we had was to go back another day, so we went back. I think the next Sunday we went back, and we saw Duke Reed out there with a long gun in front of him. You know, stand up with a long gun in front of him. And two shotgun on his side, you know, with his like a murky smile, you know. And he used to have like, you know, boxes of crate of drinks, you know, gone down on that side of the road and gone up that side of the road, and nobody trouble it, nobody touch it. He'd right there in Kingston, you know, down Kingston. Nobody mess with it because it's Duke Reed. Plus, him have him cats them out there that. Watching mm-hmm. stuff too, you know what I mean? So it's like, mm-hmm. nobody mess with it because him having guns, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm, and his right. old police guy and thing, you know? It's like, so nobody mess with it for some reason. Nobody mess with it. But when we saw him with him guns and thing like that, you know, I think it was Ben who said, well, we don't come back down here yet, so we're not gonna do that again because, mm-hmm. you know, that's the vibe we have to go on now. We won't do it. Let's not do it. So we decided right. we wouldn't go back.
Right.
But then it's not long after that I met Errol Grandison and
Albert.
And shortly after that became Gladiators.
Right.
I mean, the tension that Duke Reed gave, I mean, was that a testament to the good recordings that would go on? Think you know, about it. If you're a musician, if you're like, oh, we better get this in one take.
Yeah, you know? I think they kind of know him. So, you know, I know so well then. He's a comic. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? But when you don't know. You know what I mean?
Right, yeah.
It's not shoot you. You know what I mean? It's not like, you know, yes, if you go to Robin, yes, you know. But he's not going to do anything. He's going to have it there. You know what I mean?
Right, hey, right.
You know, that kind of vibe, like, you know.
Well, I heard he would shoot up, like, if there was a good recording session or whatever, you know.
Yes.
Did you hear about that too? Like he would just shoot up the place, kind of.
I hear about that. I heard about the one with Tin Leg, the drummer, Tin Leg.
Yeah.
You know, who run out of there, left his drummer, never go back for it.
we had Basie Val Douglas on the show a few months ago, and he told us that story about
Tin Leg.
He just ran out, left the country.
I totally heard about it.
Every single artist we've had on that has. And any experience with Duke Reed always talks about his guns in the first 10 seconds. Crazy, man. I can't imagine. That's so
weird. He always have a little smile about it. There's a little smile that you don't know how to read it, you know? Mm-hmm. Is he serious or not? Is he laughing at you or not? You know, it's like, you know, right, you don't quite know.
Oh wow. Well, I mean, before we let you go, how would you feel about singing a song for us?
Uh-huh. Let's see.
It's okay if you're not in the singing mood, but
let me see. Which one again?
A wax. That's up to you.
Yeah, I know. let's see. But there are plenty, you know.
I put you on the spot.
There are plenty. Yeah. Okay, I'm just gonna do a little piece on the other side.
All right.
So long, that's where righteousness will always flow. Togetherness will ever grow. So we don't want a big pocket over there. I say you get a knocket over there. Oh no. I say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach the other side of the mountain. Yeah. I say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach the other side of the mountain. Hey, I and I shall be like sounding brass and tingling cymbals. With gifts of mistress to remove mountains. Oh yes. Hey, I and I shall be like sounding brass and tingling cymbals. With gifts of mistress to remove mountains. Oh yes. Hey, music, flowers, and children will be there. That's where everyone shall get an equal share. So we don't want no warmongers over there. No gossiper, no traitor shall be there. Oh no, I say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach beyond the side of the mountain. Yeah. I say your hands and your heart got to be clean to reach beyond the side of the mountain.
Yeah, such a classic.
Oh man, thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Besides the amazing voice, I mean, the guitar playing, as to some people, as simple as it may sound to some people, like that, just the skank, it's just different than anybody playing that's not from Jamaica. And it's like you were saying earlier, Clinton, there's something there that, as simple as to some, just the skank may be, like, it's like, no, it's just a fearless little swag to it.
You're right. And that's what I was talking about there, you know, without trying to own it or anything. You know, I'm not even trying to own it. I'm just observation.
It's so true, man. I mean, you can be, me and Devin, you know, we love old school Jamaican music, and sometimes it's fun to like really emulate and try to mimic certain eras and stuff. And you're just never, ever, ever, ever going to do it, you know, because it's magic, man. There's some magic to it.
And that's why we have to just, you know, accept what is, you know, because the thing is, it's, you know, at one time in Jamaica there, you know, the music union in Jamaica, you know, the cats who control it at the time, some of the Bradshaw and some other ones, you know, they try to like write reggae, like written music, you know, and try to like control something on JBC and to discredit certain things and things like that. They had us to quit because 3/4 or more of reggae music is just feeling.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, you can't write feeling. You know what I mean? You write notes, yeah, but you cannot write feeling.
Definitely. You know?
Right. And so that's the part that you know, you have to come there and live there for a long time and develop and so forth, you know. So when you naturally talk in the kind of way, walk in the kind of way, mm-hmm, then you start to feel that way too as well. You know, and that's what comes out in the music.
Mm-hmm. For sure. You know, go ahead, Clint.
So I would say as this is as an advice, you know, if you are gonna play reggae music, play it your style. You know, how you feel it. Just do an honest job with it. It will define its people. Because no matter how you try, it's not gonna be like how a Jamaica musician would play it. You know, that with the same feeling. You understand? Marky, what you do could even be better. But it won't be that same feeling, that feeling, you know what I mean? Because the accent that we were talking about, like the accent or your talk or your walk or your breathe, all of that goes with, you know? Mm-hmm. You know, people from hot countries, you know, even from hot countries like Africa, for example, which was the part that's hot, you know, mm-hmm, Jamaica hot. You know, you put the two things together and it's still different because they talk different. You know what I mean? And the accents are different.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Definitely, anyway. Man. No, for sure.
That's great advice. I mean, it's true. You know, just to do
so
your,
true.
Just with any music, you know, just do your thing. But I think you nailed it with the be honest. Be honest about it. You know, do your honest thing, and that's good things will happen from there.
Yeah, man.
Did you write? Did you write the tune "Downtown Rebel" from that era? You just reminded me of it right now, playing that song.
Oh, Downtown Rebel! Oh, yeah. Hear me now.
When you were playing on the other side right now, I was just like, it just brought that tune into my head because it's like same era, right? Studio One. That's a tune.
Right, that one. And the original one of this one, if you listen to the original one too, you know, I had a cold day when I went in to voice it. I told Coxon that, Sir D, I need to come back and voice this one. You know? And said, no, man, it's all right like it is. That's why when you listen to the you know, you hear it sound different. If you listen to it, you'll hear it, you know. I could hardly say anything, but I managed to belt the song out, you know. I'd come back from Ronnie and say, Sir D, we need to do this one over another time. I need to come back and do it over. So no man, it's all right as it is.
Nice.
Is it?
Well, that's good. Are you talking about On the Other Side or Downtown Rebel? Which one?
On the other side.
Okay.
You know, I mean, the original one, the first
The studio one. That's so funny to hear stories like that, you know, because to us, that's just such an iconic song, and I can't imagine it sounding any different. You know, it's perfect to me. But you're like, no, I needed to do that over.
Yeah. Well, I literally was sick though, like really rather cold, but I went to studio because I know, you know, it's my opportunity, so I don't want to pass up my opportunity, you know.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But anyway, you know, they're a producer and they have ideas and you know, and maybe it was a good thing. You know?
Right.
Yeah, you got a little rasp in your voice. Sometimes it sounds good. All right, sir. Well, Clinton, thank you so much for coming on with us again. Can't thank
most
you
welcome. Thanks for having me twice, man. I'm honored.
The honor is all ours. You are our first repeat guest, and couldn't think of a better candidate for that. So
right,
man. Like I say, you know, I'm honored. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody. Make sure you tune in to Clinton Fearon's every other Sunday. His 10 a.m. his morning live sessions. It's the best way to get your Sunday going you could think of. And then also, let's see, this Wednesday he's got a Talk with a Friend, right? This coming Wednesday. I can't wait for that. We just talked so much about him. Now I can't wait to hear you guys.
It will be fun.
All right, sir. Well, happy birthday month again.
Yeah, man.
Okay, peace.
Say goodbye to Catherine for us.
We'll see you, Catherine.
Yes,
the amazing,
so nice.
Yeah, man, he sounds so good, for real. It's like that makes me miss live music more,
so much,
right? And like, you take for granted, and now I'd be like, I'd give anything just to go and see Clinton perform live at the Nectar. You know, jeez.
Like me and you were texting about earlier today, man. I'm just like, Roger made some joke like, oh, you know, I'll pick you up and we'll go over to the turtle racing spot. And it hit me. I was like, I really, really want to do that. Like, that sounds so good. I want to go to the turtle racing spot and get some drinks right now. But soon enough, it'll happen.
You start missing stuff.
Man. But
yeah, I got so big news.
You do?
No, I don't. Just because my section says follow on Instagram.
Oh. Well, we do have big news. It's that February 4th, we have Freddie McGregor, the Freddie McGregor, joining us on the Reggae Podclash. Talk about getting nervous, you know?
Yeah, man.
Artists you admire, that Freddie McGregor is like one of those larger-than-life characters, you know?
It definitely is, man.
I'm like, man, Freddie McGregor. So yeah, that's going to be February 4th, and that will be our last. So, you know, we did it on Saturdays all 2020, and then you'll have noticed that these last couple episodes have been Thursday, and February 4th is also a Thursday, and that's going to be the last Thursday of the Reggae Podclash, and then we're moving to Wednesdays permanently, we hope. starting February. What'll that be? February 18th, I believe, is the one after that. But we'll figure that out. But February 4th, Freddie McGregor, Thursday
yes.
at 6 p.m. Come with your questions. You know, he knows all about ships, both big and little.
Ships, both yeah. big and little. Legend for sure. I got no new news, man. Follow me on Instagram. Ladies and gentlemen, I always put up little cool clips, so just follow me on Instagram.
That's crazy. You always got something going on. I feel like I need to make something up for
you. Dude, I really have some really, really cool things that I just can't wait to share, but it'd be premature to talk about them, but they're probably some of the bigger things I've ever done in my life, so... It's going to be really cool. They're on deck, and I'm keeping busy.
Well, then definitely follow Roger on Instagram so you can keep up with that. Follow us both, why don't you? Follow me on Instagram, too. And I'm just doing my songbook sessions every Tuesday at 5 p.m. I'm giving guitar lessons and vocal lessons and songwriting lessons. Hit me up for that, please. I love giving lessons. Hit me up. You can hit me up directly, or you can do it through backstagemusiclessons.com. Go follow me on Twitch, because I'm going to do a DJ party soon. I've been talking about it, but I've only got like 17 followers, so I need to get to 30. That's what I said last time. And
30 is like, they don't let you do that?
No, they do. They do. I just feel like...
That's your own kind of...
You know what I'm saying? If you have like on Instagram, I've got like 3,000 followers, and I go live and like... 15 people watch, you know what I mean? So it's
what
like,
if those 17 go hard though?
Maybe they will. I'm gonna make sure they go hard, because I'm gonna go yeah. hard with a promotion. I'm gonna like, it's not just gonna be like random live DJ night. I'm gonna set it up, make a little flyer. I've got this friend that does graphics.
Yeah, there's a lot of people that do graphics nowadays. It's crazy.
No, there aren't. Just one guy. I'm gonna hit one him guy. Up. And he's usually pretty nice about this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And get a flyer going. I heard he's busy though, but anyway, Rachel in the comments says Bernie Whaler. Haha, that's we saw your photo.
Oh man, yeah. If you guys, if you want a quick laugh, go check out one of the several million memes of Bernie Sanders that's going around. I just had to jump into Photoshop and throw in Bernie
so
with
all the Bernie memes have been so good. The merch guy meme where he's sitting at the merch booth. That's probably my
favorite. That was good. Yeah, so yeah. Good. There's a couple of good ones. Yeah.
People are funny, man. Like, you know, sometimes you're like, people are the worst, but then you're like, wow, people are hilarious too.
Yes. Yes. new levels of humor are being reached because of the internet for sure.
Yes, that's true. All right. So February 4th, got Freddie McGregor coming up. And I think that's about it, man. Hit us at the Reggae Podclash at gmail.com. Oh, you know, don't forget to go subscribe to the podcast. You can get this in podcast form. Please, even if you already do, if you can go like it and give it a 5-star rating, that kind of stuff like bumps us up in the charts and the visibilities. We're trying to get to the point where you can just type in Reggae Podcast and we're the first thing that shows up. And that is made possible by everybody giving reviews and 5-star ratings and all that kind of stuff. So please go follow the Reggae Podclash in your favorite podcast app if you have not done so already. And because I didn't mention it earlier, the last thing I want to mention is the Reggae Podclash merchandise store. You can go visit the merch store. It's up and running, and I think we're doing free shipping right now.
Free shipping.
I don't know if I'm supposed to, if that's like a premature announcement, but I think what I heard is that we're doing, look at that mug, that we're doing free shipping on everything. So you can get shirts, hoodies, crop hoodies, beanies, hats, that little like Gilligan's hat at the bottom, all kinds of stuff. So make sure you go.
I got to get one of those.
I know. You'd look good at Gilligan's hat.
I would. A white one.
How do I get this off? Here we go. All right. Okay. Well, thank you very much to everybody who tuned in and to our guest, Mr. Clinton Fearon. Happy birthday month to him. Rootfire is doing a month-long feature on him as part of their Center Stage with Reggae Icons series. And so you can, you know, just keep stopping by rootfire.net. You know, go there to the merchandise store, get some Reggae Podclash merch, and then stick around to check out the Clinton Fearon coverage. And until the next show, which is February 4th with Freddie McGregor, Roger, good to see you.
Evan, great seeing you.
And I hope everyone stays safe and is well. Talk to you all soon.